afternoon. My name is Beth Roberts, and I want to welcome all of you to this featured session on behalf of AnitaB.org. AnitaB.org's mission is to connect, inspire, and guide women in computing and organizations that view technology innovation as a strategic imperative. We envision a future where the people who imagine and build technology mirror the people and societies for whom they build it. Constance Steinkuehler is a professor of informatics at the University of California, Irvine, where she researches the cognitive and social aspects of esports and multiplayer online video games. Her work has been funded by the MacArthur Foundation and the Gates Foundation, just to name a couple. Constance has also formerly served as a senior policy analyst under the Obama administration in the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, advising on video games and digital media. She is the founder of the Higher Education Video Games Alliance, an academic organization of game-related programs in higher education. And currently, she serves on the advisory board for the UCI Esports Program and chairs the UCI Diversity and Inclusion in Esports Task Force. Please help me welcome Constance Steinkuehler to the stage.
And thanks for coming. I'm very grateful to be here. This is my third Grace Hopper event, and I've always found it to be a real shot in the arm for the work that we do. So today I had a talk planned that was based on the book that I'm working on that's supposed to be this study through all of the reasons that games are not so harmful and about how women need to re-embrace their play and how games, especially for teenage boys, is caught up with hyper-parenting pressures on women. And then I don't know about you, but this last week or two where the level of sexist toxism out in our universe is getting so high that I sort of felt like another story telling women about what they ought to do feels really tedious and tiring right now. So I'm going to do something that I don't normally do. I'm going to actually try and walk through my relationship with play. And I want to talk about some of the problems that we've had in my industry and in academics, and sort of see if we can connect it to something that's bigger than just games themselves or games industry itself. So I guess this is the version of, this one is sort of like the one woman show. I'm just gonna tell my story and hope that I'm not alone. On that note, how many of you are gamers? How many of you game? Let me ask that question differently. Wow, I'm so glad. I usually, feel like the first confession I have to give is the fact that I don't just play games, I actually am a gamer. I identify as being a gamer. It's a primary place for me to work out my identity. And I want to start at the beginning of how that sort of happened. So this is my biker gang, circa 1976. We were a really rough crowd. I grew up in the 70s where we still had, you know, children playing on cul-de-sacs thrown outside until the pole lights came on and then you could come back indoors. And these were really rough and competitive and mean spaces. I mean, I have very vivid and fond memories of trying to light my brother on fire. It didn't work. I swear, I just was throwing matches. I wasn't that vicious. But they were verbally competitive. They were rough and tumble. We had no problem getting dirty. And no one except for maybe my Southern Belle mother ever tried to make me play a different way. It was sort of at that age, it was okay and it was possible for you to be in that space together and both of you sort of taking swings at each other and then still going home friends, no matter whether you're male, female, or whatever your orientation. Of course, you know, about 5 years later, this is somewhere around, what, 80, 81? Atari 2600 came out, and at this point, my own family, my parents, would never have trusted me or my brother having access to the TV in this way. So we had to go over to neighbors' houses, and we played Atari 2600. I'm probably totally, I've just dated myself. So, oh well. But we played the crap out of some Pac-Man and some Asteroids and Centipede. And again, we were cheek to jowl, we were elbow to elbow, all playing rough and fun and competitive and hard. And that continued up and through teenage years. You know, my very first memory of even finding boys more than disgusting and wanting to light them on fire was in a mall arcade. And there are very few signals here that this might be a space that's welcoming to women. Right, you've got at least Ms. Pac-Man, which even today I can impress my grad students because I will leaderboard everyone out of that game. I don't have a lot of skill, but Ms. Pac-Man, I will rock. Any of the other ones, not so incredibly impressive. But, you know, again, you had these spaces that were sort of, they were always mixed gender, but they were also kind of rough and tumble. In the 1980s, I just want to pause a moment and just, I'm rocking it, aren't I? I know. You know, I went to grad school on a land grant. I'm the first generation to go to university. My family is a long line of farmers in the middle of Missouri. I ended up doing 3 degrees. I was the only woman in the math department, which was a daily humiliation. I hated being left out of the study groups. I hated being treated like the person that was not setting the curve and the one that someone had to tutor. But I also did another, at the same time, a degree in feminism, and that sort of offset the other part, right? And I got really into this scene where girls cussed. I did scratch out my cuss words in these slides, I'm very proud to say. But we learned how to be rough, we were gorilla girls, we were punk, we were harsh, we wore lots of lipstick and short, slutty little outfits. We marched around and said, what are you gonna do about it? And it was incredibly emancipating, especially coming from Missouri. And I learned that, in fact, I really kind of cut my teeth the whole time in these spaces that, you know, that are rougher. But in college, I sort of set games aside and they really didn't come back to me, or I didn't go back to them, until somewhere in graduate work, which is a really weird time to pick up games. I had come to do a PhD in educational psychology, the two fields I swore I would never go into, education and psychology. And what did I go into? Educational psychology. It turns out the things I hate are usually the things I don't understand. So I came back, and that's where I got into games. I was working on these sites like Tapped In. I mean, this is right. This is like 1998. Okay, go back in time with me, young people. Go back, right? The internet started booming around 1995, but it wasn't until 1998 that about 50% of the US population had the intertubes. So I was very excited about the idea of what would people do online. And for me, I was very interested in what they called cold cognition. I wanted to look at what are the forms of thinking and reasoning and argument that people could do online together? How could we solve problems together? Wow, right now in history, it seems like that's a weird thing to say I now study games, but let me see if I can get us there. So I'm studying these sites. This is Tapped In. Fabulous site at the time. It's like a big chat room space. You could do some light programming to make things like a cup of coffee that steam rolled off of in text. This was a big deal. So we were developing these spaces, and I was looking at reasoning among groups in chat rooms and Tapped In. And what I found is that I could show statistical significance in terms of the tasks that we gave people, that they were doing better at the end of it than before, and blah, 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 blah. But if you read through the transcripts, it was clear that they were awkward, horrible activities, and that people hated doing them. I mean, imagine for a moment spending 45 minutes talking about a controversial issue like creationism versus evolution with an absolute random stranger in a chat room in 1998. Not fun, right? I'm almost like redesigning the weird spaces I grew up in, like caustic and awful. So I got very frustrated with trying to study cognition in these spaces because, really because trying to look at cognition that way is a bit like hiring the tabernacle choir to hum, right? You're just not seeing what people are capable of. So another advisor of mine, James Paul G, who's one of the leading game scholars, he was actually a literacy scholar. He was one of my advisors and he said, Constance, you're studying the wrong space. Stop making your lame little chat rooms and go study games. He had just started working on this game, on this book title. And so I did exactly as I had been advised. I dropped everything I was doing and I logged into my first MMO. And started studying games straight from there. That's what it looked like. I did this very heavy titled Cognition Learning in Massively Multiplayer Online Games, a Critical Approach. And there's my character. I'm still proud of her. I was a siege princess. I found my home in these game spaces. They were a place that for me, I could do something that I think in my real world I didn't feel comfortable doing, and that was things like being competitive, like trying to be better than everyone else, trying to I guess, play rough and also siege stuff, which seemed like a lot of fun. Being a siege princess meant running a guild of 350 people. We took 5 of 6 castles on our server, so we kind of were badasses, I guess. I think of those two things, which is more important, my dissertation or the experience of being a siege princess? And for me personally, it was probably being a siege princess. But I did generate a dissertation out of this. And part of the findings were that this was a really important sort of discursive space. This was a space in which there are shared practices, there were shared values that you use to display your insiderliness, right? So for example, in Lineage, there were noobs versus what was called beta vets, veterans from the beta days of this particular title. You positioned and jockeyed to get yourself identified as more or less expert in this space. It was an interesting and really important identity space for people to be in. And little did I know I would spend the rest of my career studying this kind of phenomenon, right? How people online form communities and how those communities have shared values, right? Some of which we may like and some of which may be very orthogonal to what's productive offline. But this was also a really weird time. I mean, this was a period where there were booth babes, there was no indie scene at all. And there were very few women game researchers. And yes, booth babes. Is there anyone who needs me to explain this? I still, when I see this, feel a little shocked. E3 is proud of themselves for finally toning down booth babes. But for a good, 5 years of my early career, a little bit longer than that, you'd go to professional conferences and you'd be not only one of the only women there at like E3, where it's a sort of a PR event for media coming out, but you'd be in the bathroom, there'd be no other women except for women that were either in Daisy Duke shorts or in crazy outfits like nothing, and then like a helmet with horns, like a Viking helmet, just like nothing. And you're like, that's cold and practical. I don't know what to say, right? So this was kind of the period of games, right? There were women there. I want to put some faces up. I'm going to talk about Gamergate, but I am not going to show the crap of Gamergate. I'm going to try not to. I want to instead put up the women that actually were in this space, and this is just a few of them. So there were some really terrific women, all of whom have become these leaders in their spaces, and they were blogging and writing and co-researching and convening with all of the guys. This just felt like more of the same to me, more of like a good, well, not the same as game space, but another space in which women were the minority, but certainly an important presence. But there was also a lot of shenanigans, and that's my polite word for saying sexist bullshit, which I just said, which is now going to get streamed, and I apologize for my language, but I'm not sure what other word you use for it right now. There were very few women characters. The ones that were out were basically pantsless and looked like booth babes. There weren't a lot of women in senior positions in the industry or present at all. Many of my friends in the industry, and this still happens sometimes, there were things like the only women's bathroom is in the lobby, right? You had sexist behavior in games. You had a lot of stuff that you were fighting against. And I think for myself, I felt really well armed because I grew up in this sort of neighborhood of rough and tumble. I had brothers. I was used to fist fighting. Sorry. I liked the competition. I also had sort of gotten used to being the minority, but taken seriously. But it did all come together to mark these spaces as kind of a boys' play space. I would be remiss to pretend like that's not true. It is true. When you see the ways in which women were depicted in these games, and still are, a lot of it just sort of signals that the discourse is a discourse of a male's gaze, right? Well, 2014 happened, and World of Warcraft launched. Are there any WoW players in here? Awesome. Still download and then play and delete and download and play and delete, download, say it's the game I hate but still play and then delete. I'm still doing that. World of Warcraft took what was this marginalized activity of gaming in a multiplayer space and made it mainstream. It made it, for a variety of design reasons, design choices such as you know, reducing the amount of play time necessary in a single setting to do something of interest, simple things like that. They managed to build an MMO that made this activity mainstream. And with that, my own work got a good uptick because suddenly everybody was playing in these spaces. So with the help of MacArthur Foundation and Spencer Foundation, some private foundations that were willing to invest in early research, we really tried to explore some of the kind of ethnographic findings that we found in my dissertation. So we ran a whole bunch of studies, a whole bunch of really interesting studies about how people reason in these spaces, what might these spaces be good for, et cetera. You know, we looked at like scientific habits of mind. It turned out, this is no surprise for people in MMO spaces, but it turned out that there's a ton of sort of scientific kinds of forms of thinking and reasoning and valuing that happen in things like theory crafting. You can also see like these long traces of mathematical models that players will produce. This was very exciting to me because I was studying, you know, comparing it to things like classrooms where it's very difficult to get kids to think about a mathematical model of something in the universe and how that model relates to the universe and how that model might predict the universe and how would you argue about the model's usefulness based on prediction, right? But then you'd go in these play spaces and kids were doing it not just on their own, but also paying in order to be able to participate in it and declaring it nothing but fun. And this was very exciting to me. It still is exciting to me, actually. And if you looked at the way these discussions were happening, they weren't just like, let's say, how we do in academics, where you have this ivory tower that are solving problems while everyone waits for the answer from research. Instead, what you saw was that the harder the problem, the more people pitched in. So you saw things like the harder the problem, the longer the posting threads, and the more people participated, with an average about 2 posts per 1 person. Right? You can imagine a world in which it was only 50 smart people solving problems in the game while everyone else waited for the answer. But instead, what you saw was this really collective problem-solving activity, which is really exciting to see. And we looked at things like literacy. Not only what are the kinds of texts that go into games, because this was about 2005, 2008, there was a huge literacy scare that games were going to replace reading. In fact, some of that rhetoric has now sort of resurrected itself, and we're back having that conversation again. But there was a real worry in America that kids that were playing games and not reading books and print texts. So we did studies on things like what kind of practices are involved with gaming, how does it relate to print reading, print text, and writing and not. We found things like this. We showed that, so when this is a study of 25 kids, all males, which I'll explain in a minute, but you find that when you allowed kids to read text they cared about, they were actually able to read up to 8 grades above their head at the independent level. Looked at another way, if you take a group of struggling and non-struggling readers, it turns out when they get to choose the text for something they care about learning, all of that struggling behavior goes away, and all you have is successful readers. Now, is the magic there games? Actually, I would argue it's interest, not games. But of course, games are really, really compelling spaces for building and scaffolding interest. That's what designers do, right? We also found that for the MMO spaces, many of them kids were using as sort of the new third place. So a place that wasn't work nor home, but in fact they were sitting around in World of Warcraft. And actually while they were doing this activity, they were building social capital. And not just building social capital, but building a very particular form of social capital called bridging social capital. So in America, we have very few spaces, or we had kind of designed out. We've kind of gotten better about it now with mixed-use space. But post-World War II in America, we really kind of designed out these multi-use spaces where people could hang out. So, you know, people tend to live in a neighborhood and drive to work and then drive to, like, a store to shop. And there weren't, at that time, a lot of spaces where people could simply be together without it being planned. What happens in those spaces, like World of Warcraft, like a coffee shop is that that's where you build your bridging social capital. And by bridging, I mean the kind of social capital where these may not be your best friends, these may not be your closest friends and family, but they are the people that, in fact, you get the most new ideas and the most diversity from, right? These are your casual associations that also actually lead to more jobs, lead to new ideas, and tend to be with people that don't look like you, don't share genes with you, don't share political views with you. See, part of the magic of these MMO spaces and gaming spaces is that it brings together a lot of different people who in other domains online would be siloed in their own groups. So for example, I don't know about you, but I don't spend a lot of time on some of the boards, let's say on Reddit, that I find to be offensive or toxic. I tend to go to places where they tend to agree with me. They share my politics, they share my views, they share my loves, right? They share my backgrounds. It's part of the internet's problem that we end up reifying our own social groupings. But here were these MMO spaces where, in fact, people were playing together and not realizing that they would hate each other in real life, basically, which may explain some of what happened next. Well, in the meantime, you know, there I am studying games, everything's gorgeous, and then I have these two little boys. And I remember I was teaching technology and gender at the time, but the truth was, what I was really teaching was women in computer science, right? We have a major problem, actually, with women in science, but women in computer science, let's just say that's the cherry on the top. We have a hard time attracting women to our domain. We have a hard time retaining women in this space. And there's a lot of reasons one might call it an overdefined problem. There are more reasons to explain why than there are solutions to it, right? That's part of what many of us are trying to work on. So I had been teaching a class on gender and tech, and then I had two boys, and I realized I really didn't know anything about boys. So I started studying them. You know, it's a good idea. You have them, and you're like, what am I going to do now? Like, I don't know anything about you. So I started looking, and what you start seeing is really shocking. So just a few highlights of the problem. 65% of boys graduate high school. They underperform and opt out of literacy coursework. They score consistently lower on the NAEP, one of our best exams. In other words, boys in the nation read two grades below average of where they should be. And this has been going on for so long that I kid you not, the first study I tried to publish on this, the editor said to me, this is a nice paper and I like your study. However, your intro is hyperbolic. This is not a crisis. It's been going on for 30 years. And I was like, dear editor, 30 years makes it a double-do crisis. So heavy regards, me. It didn't work. But remember, so here we were facing these problems with boys and reading. And at the time, I had just done all these studies looking at how games and reading are these really interesting allies, right? You've got these spaces where kids are reading for interest. The reading of game text, by the way, is 12th grade literacy on average, with a 4% academic profile of vocabulary. These are, if you're a reading nerd like me, these are the perfect storms for literacy interventions, especially with boys. And yet here we were in this world in which males, even for World of Warcraft, 18% female on average, right? These are predominantly still male play spaces, and yet here my work is saying that these games are about literacy, but boys are still doing really badly in school. So I wanted to study this. I got into it, started trying to think about, could we use games? You could substitute any fandom in there, but games are the one I know. But could you use that as sort of a gateway drug into academic ideas? Could you get kids reading and understanding that reading isn't something you do when a teacher tells you, it's what you do to hack the world, right? Science is what you do to hack the world, not what you do in the classroom. That was the big idea. And we ran programs, and we even, here's a lovely shot of one of them. That's what they look like online. So we ran these big programs in World of Warcraft. I have to tell you, at the time, we didn't even have to recruit for these programs. These were research programs, but we ran them like after-school clubs because so many parents were worried about their teenage boys and their gaming habits that literally the moment we got the IRB through, we had people line up to give us their children. I had a mom who actually put her two sons on a bus. They rode 2 hours to come to our campus to participate on Saturdays in our club. It was really actually humbling, to be honest. So we ran these programs, and we found really interesting results. It turns out that even when we compared it to programs, like ours was totally interest-driven. What I mean by that was that we had no set program. There was no curriculum. You came in, we gamed, and when you said something like, oh, I wish I had better armor, we'd be like, you wish you had better armor. Well, maybe you should do something about that. And then they'd start researching, and then we'd just magically show up with some text and be like, funny, here's a book for you, right? So we really let the interest drive the whole program. But even when we compared it to much more intentional and beautifully designed curricula, Global Kids in New York, fabulous program. So we did this comparison analysis, and even when we compared it to like these really smart programs and virtual worlds doing amazing stuff with kids and dinosaurs and bones and ugh, we had really similar outcomes, right? So we started thinking, this is amazing. Like, you could have kids, if you were carefully sort of resourcing it, you could have kids, like, resourcing what they love, and you could make this a space where, in fact, games are the gateway drug into big, huge, beautiful ideas that will save us all, right? I got pulled off, and I'm not sure why I got asked to work in the White House. I asked my boss one time, and he just went, you came highly recommended. And I was like, I'm too scared to ask you what that means. But I got pulled off of that whole plan. We were just rocking it, right? And then I got asked to work for the president. So I did. I went to D.C. My youngest was a year and a half, barely weaned. Sucked. But the job was great. And what do we do? Well, game changer. I don't think so. Can I point out one thing? Because this is my talk. Can I just say, they keep calling me the game czar. I worked on like Duchess or like something super hot, and I kept getting czar, right? I'm like, I don't want to be a game czar. I want to be like a game siege princess, like, whatever. I spent several years working at the government level thinking about how do you build an ecosystem that you don't have to, I'm not talking about colonizing all entertainment games. I'm just saying, could we make some games that are amazing for people? Could we build this innovation ecosystem in the States where we could think about even a small portion of the joy and design that goes into games going into solving some of our national problems? Simple things, actually not simple things, horribly difficult things, but recognizable issues like childhood obesity. How about turning the lights off when you leave the house, reducing our energy footprint, right? These are actually solvable problems with game-type strategies. And we did all this tremendous work. And we rolled it out nationally, woohoo! And we did stuff like formed organizations. We went from 12, maybe 15 programs when I was a grad student. By the time we rolled out the Alliance, that was 2013, maybe? There were 409 programs on games in the higher ed. So we did all this work. And then, you know, at the same time, we had this dynamic going on in the market. So around 2012, 2013 was the rise of mobile. So the rise of mobile made all this difference in games. It meant that suddenly you had your grandmother gaming in the line of shopping, like of the shopping mall, right? It suddenly meant that a whole broader audience was playing. And games, I stopped having to start every talk I gave with, I swear I'm not trying to make people violent, fat, antisocial, you know, addicted. I just think games are actually good, right? I think they're actually cool. After, like, once mobile became a thing, games became very normalized. It also meant that there were a lot more women playing. Unity was part of the big trend there. Unity overtly, is there anyone from Unity here? There's gotta be people from Unity. Oh, thank you. Unity is amazing. Unity's amazing because John Grigotello overtly talks about democratizing game development. You know, I don't think the indie scene would have happened if it weren't for the fact that game design tools became cheap and readily accessible. right? This started shifting everything. So that instead of just having AAA companies with their booth babes, like when I was cutting my teeth as a scholar, instead we had this huge thriving indie scene spot prop up. I mean, it is, games are in a golden age right now, right? Of course, you know, that also meant we had a much more diverse community playing. As ESA likes to tell us, 45% of gamers are female, which is true, right? You just saw, like, I don't know, probably like 70% of the audience here is gamers. That also hides some of the stats about where people are at, because men and women don't always play the same things. This is some data from Nick Yee and Nick Duchenet. They do some really nice work looking at what genres of play women prefer. And if you look at the top categories, again, why did mobile open up this space for women? Because suddenly it was casual games, games that you could stop on a dime. I have my own theories about that. I think that women are less committed to sit down and play for 4 hours, but that's just my own thing. But you saw women entering all these spaces, right? And then, yeah, how many of you went through Gamergate with me? Come on, put your hands up there. I need some sisters in the audience. Yeah. Are you guys still in games? Still playing or still in the industry? Yes. Yeah? Good. Good, then I'm not lying when I get to my next point. So Gamergate happened. This is CNN's rendering of a very simplified version of what Gamergate was. But somewhere in 2014, there was this perfect storm of stupidity online. I'm just going to say that. I'm tenured. I can say whatever I want. So if there are any Gamergaters watching my video, you just go ahead and email me, because you'll find I like a fight. So you had, you know, you had this niche, small fringe group of gamers who kind of rallied the troops behind this sort of incoherent thing that was sort of about ethics and journalism, but no, wait a minute, it was about the feminist takeover, and then it became the feminist takeover. But you had this small niche group, some of whom weren't even gamers, decide to absolutely terrorize, and I mean terrorize, women in the industry, and women in academics, and women who are writing, women who are thinking about games and contributing, right? So under this rubric of, you know, ethics and journalism, you basically had this whining tantrum of feminist takeover of games. What I love about this is that I'm sort of like, we were in your base killing your dudes since the dawn of time. But let's just pretend it was a takeover. Great, it's a takeover. And you had so much tantruming. I hope every feminist has their head severed from their shoulders. Or such beautiful insights as, don't pull the gender card. You're not being harassed because you're a woman. You're being harassed because you're an ignorant. Now I gotta say that word. And one of my favorites, because I love things that aren't grammatical, that really convinces me of their points. It's a normal. It's part of gaming. Stop being such a, or I'll rape you. Super. Okay. So this is the nicer stuff that colleagues in our field got. Zoe Quinn, Anita Sarkeesian, right? And it wasn't just one or two or five targets. It grew and it grew and it grew, and you had women with their personal information being put out. It was really interesting at the time because I thought, oh, you guys are enacting every stereotype I've had to like tamp down since the beginning of studying games. Super frustrating, right? But this whole thing crescendoed among other wonderful conspiracy patterns. One of them was that DIGRA, one of the central kind of games conferences, became the mothership of the feminist takeover in games. This was like how conspiratorial the entire thing got. Now, what's so interesting about all this was that, in fact, here's my point. So you had all this toxicity, right? Crying and whining and threats, scary stuff. But what's so interesting is what happened next. You know, when I was a kid, my mom, every time there was like a tragedy, my mother would always point out to me, okay, wait, Constance, look at all the people who are helping, right? So every time something terrible happens and you start feeling afraid, go look to see everyone who's helping, right? Well, here's what happened. Gamergate, who thought that we were doing a feminist takeover over of the industry and of academics and everything else, mostly because women, because mobile had actually allowed a much broader population in our media. It turns out that after Gamergate, if it wasn't a feminist takeover before that, it is now. Like, game is on. I will say now, this is some work by Martin in 2018 in game studies. This is just a map of, it's like a big map of all the disciplines and games. Really interesting to watch how it shifts over time. Notice down there on anything with communications is basically male, females, humans, gender, 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 gender. Over in education, if you're not doing equity, you're not doing education. Just as a statement to make everyone else mad, I'm just going to tell you that now because it's true. So what was the point of all this Gamergate stuff? I don't know. Gamergate never had a point. There was never an organization. There was never some sort of, it was never a movement. It was basically like a 4chan turned 8chan whining tantrum. But what you saw after has been really, really interesting, right? Remember all the people I said, have you left the industry? And everyone was like, no, why would I leave the industry? Exactly. So not only did game academic studies suddenly have to go, oh man, gender is a huge issue, and we're not gonna ignore it anymore, that this has been marked as sort of a boys' play space. But in fact, industry has been forced to respond, right? This sort of behavior, maybe not as bad as doxing people, but harassing female players in games has been going on since the dawn of games, I think, right? And suddenly now, you had conferences, entities, businesses all come up and have to come up with policies to publicly say, yeah, this isn't cool. It's not going to be your space anymore. So you now see how even great companies like Riot, great game, but in fact the bro culture going on in games is now having to be addressed. So Gamergate, which was this really hard thing to go through, I went through it too. Gamergate, the lasting consequence is that they actually brought about the very thing they said they were against. If they thought that it was like a feminist takeover, somehow because, you know, someone is posting a feminist critique of games, they should really check into the scene now, because now we basically are in their base killing their dudes. And women like Anita Sarkeesian and Zoe Quinn, these women are fierce, as you know, because they're not sitting down. They're actually standing up no matter how hard it's been. And they're organizing, and they're writing, and they're taking on the mantle of leadership. In sum, Gamergate was a death rattle. By death rattle, I mean that I don't think any regime gives up power or control without a fight. And there's this sort of tide of history, right? Where Gamergate was the death rattle of an old model where advertisers would consider my brother the right gaze and viewer, but not me, right? Where games made title, you know, game companies made titles for my husband, but the crap for me, I felt embarrassed because she never had her pants on, right? That is how Gamergate ended up leading to its own demise. Gamergate is not the only death rattle. That is what I'm gonna say here. So let me show you, because while the news has gotten more and more sour, and I know if you're like me, I wake up and every time I have to like go on a media diet, not around games, but actually around news, I no longer let my own children listen to the news, or even listen to what the president, what comes out of his mouth, because it's so scary and toxic, right? That's a really bizarre place to be. But I'm gonna tell you now that this is a death rattle, so let me show you. So, news, I'm going to show you a bunch of data around global world trends of humanity. Because if you're like me, there have been moments in the last 2 years where I'm like, are we like going down to ultimate apocalyptic destruction? Are we just, is society sliding straight down a hill? Well, media would certainly say yes, it is. And in fact, you have, you know, covers of every news story is something like this sort of scary rhetoric. But let me show you why you need to tamp down the fear and think about it as a death rattle. Life expectancy, up. Extreme poverty, way down. Human rights, way up. And these are global, long-term, all the data we have on human beings across the globe, right? Democracy versus autocracy, Oh, that's up. Basic education? That's up. Literacy up. Maternal mortality? Way down. We're doing well. How about rape and domestic violence? Oh yeah, that's going down. Not dead yet, but it's going down. How about racist, sexist, and homophobic opinions? Oh yeah, that's going down, right? It may not sound like it when we listen to the news, but if we can do some breathing and step back and look at what the global trends are, the global trends are that, in fact, this is nothing but a death rattle of an old regime. So do we have work to do? Oh, we have a lot of work to do. And that work is going to be painful, right? It's not going to be easy being women in technology, women who actually in some way not only are online and on social media, but in fact, many of us are designers of social media. This is not an easy slog. It's not going to be an easy slog. But that does not make it hopeless. And that does not mean the world is on the edge of a precipice. It means the world is on the edge of major change and reform. And probably change and reform that we've needed for a long time. Because like me, growing up in the 70s, this entire time we've been playing in these boys' play spaces and taking for granted that it couldn't change. But the generation after me, fourth wave feminist, right? They're changing all of it. So yeah, it's coming, and we'll continue the work. And I guess if there's one point I want to make, it's that the women that are in games, that are here and have continued, we've already figured out how to fight and fight hard, so we're there too. And I hope that I can end on a message of hope there. I'll end there for questions. So they want questions at the microphone so they can capture them. Oh, yes, please. Go ahead. Any questions?
Hello?
I knew it. I was totally right about all of it, wasn't I? I told them backstage, you don't have to worry about questions. I'm completely right on every point.
Hello?
Cool. Hi.
Quick question was, the last part that you showed was a lot of these charts, all going in a great direction, but I noticed that a lot of them were from like 1600 to like 1800 till now, and the kind of a lot of the results ended around 2012, 2013. What are the results from the last 5 years?
Well, that's a really good question. I will show you. So these are all from a book on Enlightenment Now, and if you haven't, oh, sorry, I can't go back. If you haven't read it, I would highly advise it, only because parts of it are so deeply annoying and parts of it are truly awesome. But he's actually aggregating across multiple studies in many of these places. So when you see lines that are like a line plus a broken line, and he's actually going back from the very beginning of when we have data to right now. So it depends on which variable you're looking at. Some of them go all the way up to 2017. The book was published in 2018, so I think it ends around 2017.
What was the book called?
It's called Enlightenment Now.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi.
Hi. So I was thinking, and as someone who's played games online for many years, there's been a trend in game design to move from private servers and servers where you can choose who you're playing with to just public servers and just random matchmaking playing with anyone. How has that changed the discourse in your experience?
Well, the environments I've studied have gone the opposite direction. They've gone from mass groups playing randomly together where you don't get to pick who you're playing with to something more like a MOBA where you actually team up. And so the spaces I study now are more esports, so that you're actually choosing the people that you're playing with now. And now what I would say is that what you gain is a lot of control, right? I mean, one thing that there's a lot of discussion around on online social networks is that if you want to be nasty, toxic, racist, homophobic, and sexist online, why don't you go do it in your own little corner? So the rest of us don't have to do it together, right? And in some ways, that's healthy. On the other hand, what you lose are some of the bridging opportunities. I mean, if there's one thing that I have found to be a secret skill, it's probably that knowing how to talk to your opposition in ways that are convincing and in ways that you can tamp down hyperbole and try to find each other's like sort of common ground or common goals is incredibly vital, right? Especially to making a tribe that isn't just this tribe, but a tribe that's all of us, right? So what I fear that you lose in many of these spaces is the capacity for there ever to be any intersection between these tribes, so we can end up reifying them online. And I don't know what the solution is. I think that the solution's gonna be something slow and hard to define and specific to different internet communities. But in games, I mean, I would say in many ways, World of Warcraft was the biggest multiplayer, single-player game, because it was a game in which there was also no political consequence, right? You couldn't hurt each other, but it also meant that you couldn't trust each other. You didn't have to trust each other. And so when you have that, World of Warcraft was sort of a thin game for me to study because I'm interested in sort of these online cultures, which you can't develop if the game puts you on rails the whole time. So will that count for something like these siloed spaces? I don't know, we'll find out. I think at least for right now, many of us are feeling like maybe the silos might protect us from some of the rhetoric.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.